Well, I never thought of him as being like Goebbels. He's a little dwarf. I mean, most dwarves are little. And he slicks his hair down with ink, black ink and olive oil. And he was abandoned by a gypsy circus because he was too tall to be one of their people. And he ended up, when they put him on a train, and he ended up in about 1890 or whatever, getting out of the train station in Rome and walking onto the street and then going to a lawyer's office where he was immediately made a scribe. And he had been a scribe for many, many years by the time that he met Alessandro. And the greatest threat to him was the typewriter. And he was so afraid of the typewriter that he did everything in the world to destroy it that he possibly could. And that, of course, is what we call a sub-theme in the book. But it's one that was a great deal of fun because it was something certainly in extremis.
Well, it also plays back with a sense of World War I and the difference between World War I and World War II,
oh, exactly,
with the man-made machines that later will decimate people.
World War I destroyed the culture that had been continuous up until its beginning. Notice the difference, for example, between the novels that came, the writing that came out of World War I and World War II. In World War I, you had John Dos Passos, Three Soldiers, E.E. Cummings, Enormous Room, All Quiet on the Western Front, the Hemingway novels, the great British war poets. And what did you have in World War II? You had Norman Mailer, you had James Jones, mm-hmm. you had Michener, and some other stuff too, but of a much lesser quality than that which came out of World War I. Why? Because World War I destroyed whatever it was that enabled those books to come out of World War I. That was the last of it. There was a tremendous, World War I was the cardinal event, the hinge of the century, after which everything was different. And that's why I chose that war to illuminate the difference between the old world and the new world in which we now find ourselves.
Yeah. Let me just continue one bit though about Orfeo, which is that he becomes the head of the Ministry of War.
Well, he becomes the chief scribe.
Yes, and he sits there on a throne, and any information that he's told to write, he changes it. There is such a sense of evil in this man. And he finally turns to Alessandro and says, your family has almost used up all its favors, all its gratitude for me.
Mm-hmm. In fact, he says, I'm sick and tired of doing favors for you, when in fact they kept him alive for years and years and years. And he's an example of bureaucratic power gone wild. And in the end, but I don't want to give anything away, but in the end, when Alessandro survives the war and everything, he comes back and he actually kills Orfeo, and the line that he says when he's telling Niccolo about this, he says, I had done it. I had actually killed a bureaucrat. And I thought that was very satisfying, I must say.
Anyone who has ever cut across red tape will sort of stand up and cheer at that moment. But he also does, there is a scene that again, you know, the father scene, but then we get to the point where Alessandro is going to be killed as a deserter with his men, with the men he has fought for. And if you're going to die with other men who have given up their lives as well, you don't want to be saved.
No, you see, Alessandro had a very good friend whose name was Guariglia. And Guariglia had two little children, whom Alessandro had met. Alessandro had no children, he was single. And he, and Guariglia lived for these children. He even cut off his own leg in an effort not to be arrested as a deserter. So they would think he was a decorated veteran. Someone with only one leg have been a deserter? But they caught him and they brought him to Stella Maris where they shot everybody. And this was quite realistic. In World War I, they used to decimate their own troops at times. And they were put up in the line, and Alessandro was pardoned by Orfeo in the last act. I shouldn't be giving this away, but what the hell. But he said, switch him with me, meaning Guariglia, because he knew that it was more important that Guariglia live because of Guariglia's children. And they wouldn't do it. So they took Alessandro, they pulled him away, fighting to stay there to be shot, and knocked him on the head with a rifle, and he was temporarily paralyzed, and he watched Guariglia be shot, and Guariglia at the last said, God protect my children, and then he was shot. And later, after the war, Alessandro seeks out his children and helps to take care of them.
In some ways, Mark, one can identify this book, if you wanted to say, Don Quixote and Sancho Panza in the sense of Alessandro talking with Nicola, mm-hmm. and the sort of adventures they have of pretending not to be there, that he said, we're going to become ghosts to the world because strangers come by and see them sitting on the hill. It also is King Arthur telling the tales of a Camelot, a world that never was. But if you could also say it's Pilgrim's Progress as he goes back and recounts his life.
Well, it's also the Canterbury Tales or the Decameron, the journey, the travelers talking on the journey. It's also Lear with the king, yeah. the old king, the raging mad king, and the fool who is not a fool. There are many, many precedents in literature for this type of setup, if you want to call it that.
You know what it is? You have done what is so rare in American writing. First of all, you've got the literary foundation. I mean, we mm-hmm. talked earlier about the education, where you have been, and then you have taken it and by osmosis made it part of yourself and written it as only Mark Halperin can.
Well, thank you. I try not to be one-dimensional. You see, so much of modern literature is one-dimensional because people think that the idea of literature is to transfer an idea. Well, it isn't. It has a much wider range than that. It has to deal with the emotions. It has to deal with sensation. It has to talk. It has to be concerned with philosophy. Yes, with all kinds of things. It has to be everything. It has to reflect life itself. And we, in this age of tremendous specialization, because the economy is rich enough to afford that, have people who walk down very narrow channels. And that's one thing that's wrong with our writing. It tends to be so limited and spare. I believe that the tradition of literature is such that it entitles the writer of a book to make a book as rich as he can, as rich as life itself. And that's what I always try to do.
Thank you. We'll be back after a short pause. We're talking with Mark Halperin, author of A Soldier of the Great War, published by Harcourt Brace Jovanovich. Mark, we talked about how this is not minimalist writing, but there are great things that go into this, such as Giorgione, the painting. What a painting can mean to one person. Alessandro keeps going back to Venice to see this one painting because, for one brief moment, it's his life.
Yes, the painting is one of the armatures upon which the book is fashioned. The painting is a famous, mysterious painting by the painter Giorgione, which is, I believe, very much misunderstood in modern times. But anyway, it represents Alessandro's life. And what it is a soldier staring at a woman who's suckling a child as a great lightning storm approaches a city. And I believe what it was, in brief, because I have to compress this, is that Giorgione was painting for a patron a standard scene, mm-hmm. and a storm arose, and he said, I can't do this. And he painted what he really felt, because he lived in the time of the plague, when everyone was dying around him. And he painted a painting which was symbolic of the struggle that he was undergoing. And in turn, it's also symbolic of Alessandro's struggle. The soldier can the only antidote for war, the only thing that will cure the soldier of his cynicism, the only thing that will resurrect him, is the woman with the child, the mother and the child that mm-hmm. he comes to see at the end. He finds them at the end.
Yeah.
That's I've done it myself. I've had the same experience, and that's what does it. And that painting is a beautiful, beautiful painting. And it was the symbol of the book.
You just said you've done it yourself. What did you mean by that?